This is what we are required to do. It's not a suggestion thing. It is a requirement. You know, it's not like you are requested to do this. No, you are commanded. You are required to do this. It is a command from the commander-in-chief. It is a directive from God. And this is what you must do. And as I have explained, that sanctification is like a railroad, okay? You need God, but also you yourself must cooperate in it, okay? And I did a little bit of a distinction last week and showed you the difference between justification and sanctification. That in justification, it is a position, it is the legal position you have, but sanctification, it is ongoing. It is not just something that happened and it's done. It is an ongoing process. You need to understand it also in this way. Salvation, when it says work out your salvation, this salvation here is synonymous to sanctification. But I want you to look at it, that salvation is explained in scripture in three ways. And it speaks of the past, the present, and the future. That's how salvation is described to us. That we are saved. It is done. It is in the past. It's done. And that speaks to justification. And then we are being saved. It is the present tense. It is happening now. This is your sanctification. But also we will be saved, and that is glorification. That is future. That's what's going to happen. The Bible talks salvation in those terms. And it is now this term, the present one. Work out your salvation. The present tense is work out your salvation with fear and trembling. It is what you ought to do. This is on us. And we looked at it and said, we looked at the antecedent of salvation. We said the word so then, or other versions uses the word therefore. My dear friends, work out your salvation. So it brings the context closer, and it says, look at what Christ has done. You must also endeavor and strive to do the same thing that Christ has done. And we pointed out, what did Christ do? He obeyed. It says he obeyed even to the point of death. Obedience is required for us. We must obey. And we looked at the address of sanctification. The address of sanctification, and I pointed out that this is addressed to believers. This is not addressed to unbelievers. Don't take this verse to unbelievers and tell them to work out their salvation. They can't work it out because it's not in. They must work out what is already in them. God must put in salvation in you so that you can work it out. It must already be in you. This verse is talking to believers only. My dear friends, or my beloved. It is that word that is only used for Christian. This is about Christian living. It is not about becoming a Christian. It is about doing the Christian walk. Okay? Sometimes we confuse things because we're putting something out of context, and then you're trying to, this is going to be an impossible thing for an unbeliever to do. You will never work for your salvation. You will never attain it, because even your righteous acts, your good works, are like filthy rags before God. It is only what Christ has done that qualifies you to be in Him. We also talked about the view of salvation, and we spoke about how obedience is central to this thing. You need to obey. Disobedient life will invite chastisement on you as a child of God. But if you're not a child of God, then we're not surprised. But as a child of God, you live the life of disobedience, you will get chastisement. Because obedience is absolutely necessary. Absolutely necessary. I also told you that if you hear a preacher talk against obeying the word of God, you run. You run. Close your ears and run. Because obedience is a non-negotiable for a child of God. And we said the action of sanctification, and we spoke about working out your salvation. That you must work it out. This is what you must do. This is what Christians must do. This is how you grow in faith. This is how you mature as a child of God. You must work out your salvation. With fear and trembling, we said, the alarm of sanctification. The alarm of sanctification. We said, it is with fear and trembling. Now I want us to look at verse 13 this morning and see what the word of God says there. But I want to read it from verse 12 to verse 13 so that we, because it's really just one thing there. In fact, in the Greek, it's just one sentence. So it says there in verse 12 of Philippians 2, "So then, my dear friends, just as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now even more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who is working in you, enabling you both to desire and to work out his good purpose." Our verse is in verse 13. "For it is God who is working in you, enabling you both to desire and to work out his good purpose." And I want to point out that the first verse, the verse 12, talks about us, and it talks about our responsibility, and it talks about our work in sanctification. As we have mentioned, that salvation, when you look at it and you look at justification, part of salvation, that is the work of God and God alone. It is monergistic. But when you look at sanctification, we are involved, we cooperate, it is synergistic. And that's what we said. And now I want us to look at this verse, verse 13, which now points to God and gives us the work of God. It points to God that, yes, this is you here, and now look at what God is doing also for the same purpose and the same thing that you're waiting for. So this one, verse 13, really, all it does is pointing out the work of God. That's what verse 13 does. Verse 12 points out our work, our responsibility. Verse 13 points out the work of God. Now I want you to see the first thing. I call it the argumentation for sanctification. The first thing I want you to see, the argumentation for sanctification, and it is in that word, for. That conjunction, for. I want you to notice the grounds why you must do this, why you must work out salvation, for. Because, and this is the argument, And he is going to give us the evidence why we must do this. He is pointing to us the motive and the encouragement for working out our salvation. I couldn't just leave that word there without highlighting it. So that is the argument. This is the highlight for sanctification. It is the argument for it. He's arguing, he's giving you the reason why you must work out your own salvation. He says, four. And then he says, it is God. That's the second thing I want you to see. For it is God, and I call this one the author of sanctification. For it is God. God is the one who began the good work in us. God is the one who saves us. God is the one who actually makes us holy. It is God who sanctifies you. For it is God who set you apart. For it is God who separated you. For it is God who called you out of darkness and brought you to his marvelous light. For it is God. It is God. Oh, you must work out your salvation because God. Because it is God. Isn't it interesting that the Trinity is highly involved in our salvation? In the initial stage of our salvation, you have got the Father who selects, who separates, who sanctifies, who makes you holy, who puts you aside, who separates you and calls you to himself. And then you have the second phase where the Son sets you free. The Son who saves you. The Son who is the Savior and dies for us and makes the sacrifice for us. And then thirdly, you would have the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, who seals us and becomes our guarantee of our salvation. He seals the deed. That's the Holy Spirit. But how it all works out in the mechanics of salvation, how it is the Spirit himself who has to come into your life and regenerate you and give you an ear so that you can hear. And then when you hear the gospel, faith is regenerated inside of you, and then you start saying, yes, Lord, and you believe. And it is the work of the triune God. For it is God. He is the author, he is the originator, he is the architect of salvation and sanctification. That's the author. I want you to see the activity number three, the activity of sanctification. For it is God who is working. Notice the tense of this. He is working. He is presently working. God is working in us. He is the one who is sanctifying us. It is Philippians 1:6 that says, being confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in us will perfect it until the day of Jesus Christ. It is him who is working. He is doing this thing. Jesus points him and describes him as the gardener in the vineyard. He is pruning. He is shaping us. He is working the vineyard as we are the branches. For he is the one who
Lord is working in us. Amen. When the scripture says work out your salvation, it is not a burden. It is not a burden. It is a joy and a delight. Because already there is a supernatural activity that is happening inside of me. And the evidence of it is me being so consumed by working out my salvation. It is the evidence that God is working inside of me. And number four, it is that preposition is working in you. That in you, I call it the anatomy of sanctification. He is working in you. This is not the God who is working with you, but it's the God who is inside of you. Oh. You see, it is necessary because inside of us there is nothing good. It is necessary that He dwells in you. It is necessary that He tabernacles inside of us, so that anything good that will come outside and work out our salvation will be the result of His indwelling Spirit inside each and every one of us. Isn't it? Paul says, he says something like this. He says, live circumspectly as wise and not as fools, redeeming the time. And he says, do not be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. And then he continues there and he says, being thankful, making songs and making melodies and being thankful to God and singing hymns and spiritual songs and all those things. And all those things come because the indwelling is there. He is in you. It's Colossians that says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. It is Corinthians that says, your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who dwells in you. It is not only Emmanuel, God with us, but it is also God in us. When I'm walking around, I am carrying the power of God because God is in me. I'm walking around with the supernatural strength because of the one who is in me. Isn't it? Greater is He that is in us than the one in the world. He is in us. In you. Obviously, I wanted to demarcate this too much, and it's all intertwined here. And he says, for it is God working in you this is what happens. And this is the anatomy of sanctification. The Spirit of God comes, regenerates me. Remember, my condition is that of a dead man. The Bible says, you who were dead in trespasses and sins. He has made you alive. So it is the Spirit of God that comes to me and dwells inside of me and regenerates me and resuscitates my life and makes me awake. And because I'm awake, now I can hear the gospel because I'm awake. So this is to say, regeneration precedes faith, because I need to be born again first before I can believe. I cannot believe while I'm dead, because a dead man cannot do anything. I need the Spirit of God to come and Lazarus will not come out of the grave without resurrecting first. The call, come out, has the power of resurrection that you can hear that call. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word. But if you're dead, you can't hear. So you need the resurrection so that you can hear, and then you can come out and respond to that. That is the anatomy of sanctification. It is His power that is in you that transforms from dead to life, from sinner to saint, that changes your disposition and changes everything inside of you. It is that power of God that needs to happen first. Number five, I want you to see the aspirations. The aspirations. And he says, working in you, enabling you both to desire and to work. The aspirations. To desire and to work. When the power of the Holy Spirit comes upon me, let me put it this way. In my sinful nature, I love sin. I do not love Christ. I don't want anything that will separate me with my sin. If you were to give me a choice to choose, guess what I will choose? I will choose my sin every day. I will choose darkness instead of light. And the Bible says, Jesus says, it is because my deeds are evil and I don't want them to be seen in the light. So I choose darkness every day. That's me. That's what I will do. But when the Holy Spirit comes upon me and changes my disposition and changes the things I like, all of a sudden, because I am regenerated inside, what I do is, all of a sudden, I love Christ. All of a sudden, I'm like, wow, this is wonderful. This is glorious. I love God because something supernatural has happened to me. For it is God who is working in you, both enabling both to will and to work. The enabling power of God so that you are willing changes your will, your disposition, the things you liked. Now all of a sudden are disgusting. Now all of a sudden you hate sin because you fear God. That is what happens to us. God, people say when we talk about this, we're meaning God forces this thing down your throat and all that. You don't understand. God makes you willing. You yourself, you know, every one of us sitting here, I know I made this decision. I know what the preacher said end, that's for sure. And that is the difference. He changes my will. He changes my will. You know, if God was to leave us and not change our will, we will not come. Because we will choose darkness every day. But He overcomes us and overpowers us and changes our disposition, and all of a sudden we love Him. We desire Him. Our will is to do what He wants. We will give ourselves to even die at a stake for Him. When previously you were running away from the gospel, when a preacher came to the door, you ran away. You were like, "Don't be busy." I know I did that. But all of a sudden, now I'm interested. When a preacher comes, I'm like, "Please, welcome." It's just a sad thing that I live here and nobody ever comes knocking at the door and saying, we want to share the gospel with you. So I don't get to do a lot of debate with some people. But I love that. I didn't used to love that. And I know that because I used to shut down whenever somebody was trying to share the gospel with me. But all of a sudden, man, I want to hear what you have to say. Lastly, the aim of sanctification. And it says, for His good purpose, or His good pleasure. For His good purpose, God will give you the power and strengthen you so that you will do what is necessary for His good purpose. It is God who gives you the power to do what you need to do. I quoted a verse earlier on in Colossians chapter 1, and it talks about Christ in me, the hope of glory. That's Colossians 1:27. When you read verse 28, it says, Him we proclaim to everyone so that we can present everyone mature in Christ and all those things. And then in verse 29, it talks about how it is the power that works in me, that enables me to do this. It is that power that works in me that enables me to do that very work of presenting everyone mature in Christ. It is Paul who says, I have done everything and worked more than anyone, yet not I, but the grace of God that is in me. All these things, all this empowerment, all these things that are, all this enabling we are given, it is so that the purposes of God will not fail. And I want to guarantee it today that God's purposes will not fail and will not be thwarted. God will achieve exactly what He has proposed. Now, if you are a literalist like I am, and I read the Bible literally until it says otherwise, until there is an indication in the Bible that this is metaphoric, or this is a spiritual thing, or something like that, I take it literally. For example, when the Bible says there will be 144,000 men in future who will serve God, I believe it. And I believe there will be 144,000. And as it says, it will be 12,000 from every tribe. I believe that's going to be exactly like that. Now, imagine, just imagine, out of the 144, maybe 5 guys say, no, I won't do it. Now you have 135. Or 144,995, to be exact. The promises of God are not true now. You have a problem. This God can't deliver on what he has said will be. But God, who is waiting in us, will guarantee that all things will happen according to his purposes. You know, the Bible says he works all things. All things. He works all things according to the power of his will. He has the ability and the power to accomplish that which he has set in motion. God has determined this, and it will be because we cooperate. When you don't cooperate, you will get chastisement, and you will cooperate. You're a child of God. You will get there. One thing is for sure. When he appears, we will all be like him. And anyone who has this hope in them purifies themselves. They purify themselves. Because it is God who is working in us. My work of sanctification is the evidence of God's work inside of my life. That's the point of this passage. My pursuit of holiness is the evidence of God working inside of my life. There is no way I will ever try and be holy without God pushing me and helping me, enabling me, strengthening me, sustaining me to be holy. There is no way. I will not try to be holy. But I need God for this to happen. And it is God who helps me to do this. You see, sanctification is not all on you. God also gives you all the tools you need to do this. He supports you. He strengthens you. He gives you the ability. What is that for? So that we are without excuse. Why am I not pursuing my holiness? It is because God has sustained me and has strengthened me so that I can do it. Pursue holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. Let's pray. Our Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you. Thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord, for your sustaining hand that is always there to lead and guide, to protect and provide. We thank you, O God, that you are the constant in our lives. Things change. Life changes. Government changes. But you are constant. And we're grateful. We're thankful, O God, for the great work that you have begun in us. And we know that you will complete it. And we thank you for your grace. And I pray, O God, that each and every one of us, dealing and struggling with various degrees of our sins, that, Lord, you would strengthen us, that you would help us, O God, to overcome, and that, Lord, we will move from one level to the next, that we will move from glory to glory, until that day when we are made and we are like Christ. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Grant, O God, to us the strength to do your will. In Jesus' name.